Like the village is probably some sort of a record that I always end up speaking in the post-lunch session. I don't know whether it is good or bad, but somehow it happens every time. I'm going to talk about the evolving doctrines. Doctrine, as you would know, provide the bedrock on which the four structures and organizations are built. They also provide guidance on how and when the military forces are going to be used in a conflict situation. Similarly, nuclear doctrines, they also provide guidelines on the structure of nuclear forces you have, and also the kind of targeting philosophy, whether it is going to be predominantly a counter value strategy or a counter force strategy or a combination of both. It also gives you the idea whether you are going to follow a strategy of deterrence by punishment or deterrence by denial. So doctrines are important, and in case of India and Pakistan, since there was no discussion on doctrinal aspect before 1998 nuclear tests, this whole debate in public started after May 1998. Interestingly, both India and Pakistan adopted what they called credible minimum deterrence doctrines. Now, minimum deterrence itself is a very vague kind of an idea, because it just talks of possessing a small number of weapons which can take on a small number of targets on the adversary's territory and cause unacceptable damage even after riding out the first strike. So in this case, the size of force is supposed to be small, the number of targets which are likely to be hit is going to be small, but survivability of that force is important. But then this is all abstract, so nobody knows what does it mean by small number of weapons and small number of targets, which will all be, I think, defined by the geographical situation in which the conflict is going to take place. Anyway, both India and Pakistan seem to be uncomfortable with the idea of minimum deterrence, so they did not want to have a minimal force, because the problem with a minimum force is that it remains vulnerable to a first strike. And therefore, both sides added the prefix credible with minimum deterrence, which means something more than minimum, to give them a more or a better comfort level. However, the idea of adopting credible minimum deterrence doctrine was to avoid getting involved in an undesirable nuclear arms race. But at the same time, it was made clear right from the very outset that this concept was dynamic. The credible minimum deterrence was not static. It was a dynamic concept, subject to change with the changes in the security environment and technological developments. Therefore, one would expect that these doctrines would evolve. And it is almost now 2 decades since the over-depressurization, so it is natural that the doctrines would change from the original conceptions. And as we have seen from the Cold War history, no one could find a perfect doctrine. The doctrines continue to evolve and change with the changes in security environment and with the technological developments. Take the example of the United States. From massive retaliation to flexible response to mutual assured destruction to limited nuclear options to the countervailing strategy to prevailing strategy. So it was continuously changing depending on the security environment which prevailed at that time and the technological developments and the kind of weapons which are available at a given point in time. So similarly, it will be, I think, unrealistic and unfair to assume that India and Pakistan will stick to their original formulations and they will not change. However, what we see here is that although practically a lot of changes have taken place, both in the technological field as well as in the security environment, I will not delve into the technological field because that is going to be then covered by Dr. Mansoor. I will mostly talk about the security environment, but with maybe a slight reference here and there of the technologies as well. Now, once the doctrines were initially developed, the delivery systems were limited, the number of weapons were limited, the weapons were of very early generation designs. So with the developments in miniaturization and availability of a variety of delivery systems, including the cruise missiles, and then moving off the competition from land and air to the maritime domain, all these changes have taken place and doctrines have kept changing. India, on its part, adopted the policy of no first use. But if you look at what India is doing at the moment in terms of posturing and in terms of its force configurations, they have practically moved away from the policy of no first use. Some people have in fact publicly even demanded from the Indian government to abandon the no first use policy. We have seen Mr. Shiv Shankar Menon, who was a national security advisor, and in that capacity he was chair of the executive committee of their nuclear command authority. So very key position he held. So he has written in his book that India is exploring the ideas of a preemptive first strike, particularly once they are certain that Pakistan is preparing for a first strike. Then Mr. Parikar, who was the defense minister in the early part of the Modi government, he has made public statements asking for the scrapping of no first use doctrine. Although they tried to explain it away later that these were their personal views, but once you are in such kind of key positions in government, your views cannot be private. It has to do something with the policy. Even in India's January 24, 2003 document, which is supposed to be their official doctrinal document, they expanded the scope of no first use by saying that India has the right to respond with nuclear weapons against any use of chemical or biological weapons against Indian territory or Indian forces anywhere in the world. So they had expanded the scope of no first use to allow them the space for using nuclear weapons even against chemical and biological weapons. So this thing was going on, and then Shiv Shankar Menon's ideas have been further elaborated and expanded and rationalized by analysts like Vipin Narang, who is a US-based analyst and scholar of Indian origin, and some others. Coming back to Pakistani doctrine, Pakistan's doctrine, although at the declarative level it is supposed to be credible minimum deterrence, but Pakistan's doctrine is aimed at not only deterring any nuclear threat or blackmail from India, but it is also designed to deter any conventional aggression by India, given India's advantage in conventional forces ratio. Therefore, Pakistan's nuclear doctrine remains sensitive to any changes in India's conventional forces and its doctrine. And that explains why Pakistan reacted the way it reacted to India's adoption of the cold start war doctrine, which was supposed to be a conventional war doctrine. And that is how Pakistan came to the formulation full spectrum deterrence, which has been misinterpreted and misconceived by many people around the world. But in a sense, it means that Pakistan has the capability to deal with a whole spectrum of threats. Now India has been propagating since February 2001 that they feel that there is a space for a limited conventional war below the nuclear threshold. And in seeking that space, they have been trying the idea of limited conventional war, which unfortunately they could not actualize during the 2001-2002 conflict. And then they blamed the slow mobilization speed of the strike forces and came up with the Cold Star doctrine, which cuts down on their mobilization times and add the element of surprise to their offensive. However, they have found out that even that is not practical because escalation cannot be ruled out, even if that kind of an operation, which they consider is limited in nature, is launched, because then you cannot predict Pakistan's responses to that. And Pakistan has made it very clear that Pakistan will respond with whatever options it has to this kind of a provocation. However, it will be futile to believe that with the nuclear deterrence, we can completely seal off all avenues of incursions and aggressions. Because nuclear deterrence is not panacea for all problems. If you start expecting that even crossing of a single individual, or at least sharing across the line of control, or a fighting patrol coming across the line of control can be deterred by the presence of nuclear weapons, I think that will be that will not be realistic. And then people start questioning the credibility of your deterrence, and they will say that your deterrence has been challenged. I think deterrence should not be taken below a certain reasonable level. That is why all nuclear weapon states maintain a fairly reasonably strong conventional capability to keep the nuclear threshold at a reasonably high level. And that is where it is. In fact, in trying to say that we are plugging the gaps which India is seeking below the nuclear threshold, we have created a perception that probably we will respond to nuclear weapons when the first bullet is fired by the Indians. The recent Pulwama crisis has shown that Pakistan has credible and sufficiently strong conventional options to deal with low-level provocations. India does have a very narrow band of moving in the conventional domain below the nuclear threshold. But the narrower this band is, the easier it is for Pakistan, because then India cannot exploit its conventional preponderance. And the limited amount of force they use, wherever they use it, Pakistan has then the capability to match it or even beat it with a greater force. And this kind of perception, which had been created particularly after the September 2016 surgical strike by India, which incidentally was accepted by the international community, they bought into the Indian narrative, and they in a way appreciated India's effort, patted them on the back, and nobody gave them even a cautionary word that you are going down a dangerous path which will lead into trouble and you can get into an escalatory dynamic. So encouraged by that, although Pakistan maintained that practically on ground India did not do anything, it was more of a propaganda gimmick, but encouraged by the Pakistani response, then they ventured on this. I very strongly feel not many people may agree with me, and but I still maintain that had we responded to that so-called surgical strike in 2016, not on the basis of what had happened on ground, but on the basis of what India had claimed to have done, and given them a befitting reply at that time, that would have discouraged them from venturing into this kind of aggressive posture which they have taken this time around. But again, as it was mentioned earlier also, that Indians had been trying to say that we are trying to set a new normal in South Asia, and they have found to their detriment that the new normal which has been set actually shows that even if this kind of incursion with the Air Force strikes, they have to pay a very heavy price for that, both in terms of loss of face and also in the terms of loss of equipment, costly equipment. So that is how the situation stands. The doctrines are evolving, but I think this recent crisis has confirmed the credibility of our deterrence, because as far as capability is concerned, that is something tangible. It is measurable and everyone knows about it. The only intangible part is the political will. And as we know, deterrence has three components: the capability, credibility, and communication. So in terms of credibility, political will is important, but it's immeasurable. And this crisis has proven that Pakistan has the required political will. So it has, in my opinion, further enhanced the credibility of our deterrence. So this is how the doctrines are going, and I think we need not be unduly concerned about it. India is going into different domains. They have already ventured into the maritime domain. They have gone into the space domain as well. Interestingly, despite the fact that this was a very low level engagement between India and Pakistan, India deployed its Navy, and Indian Naval Chief himself admitted that they had deployed units including their nuclear submarines. And that I think very clearly nullifies their claims about the no first use. That on a very small provocation where only a few aircraft were involved in that interaction, they deployed their whole Navy including the nuclear powered submarines. Now, whereas India went to United States complaining that Pakistan used F-16 in this conflict, probably against the terms of end-user agreement between US and Pakistan, I think Pakistan also needs to make polite inquiries from the Russians as to the terms of lease of the nuclear powered submarines which they have given to India, as to whether those terms of lease allow India to operationally deploy these submarines or use them in a conflict situation with Pakistan. So I will not go further than this. I think I hope there will be some questions during the question answer, because the more I go into details, I'm likely to overstep the territory which is the turf of Dr. Mansoor. So I will not delve into that, and I end here. Thank you.
Thank you so much.